Oh, okay. Seems to be working. Great. So hello, everyone. Pleasure to see so many of you here after this vacation. That took me quite, you know, so it was kind of hard like to get back into it. But here I am, and I'm delighted. So what we're going to be talking about today is a certain number of paradoxes that we are confronted to whenever we speak about time. Whenever we try to define what time is, and whenever we try to describe the experience we have of time passing, okay? So, I'm gonna begin by saying here that we're gonna do just a philosophical exercise together. For the people who never have been in one of the audios I do, I tend to try to ask you certain questions, not only at the end in like Q&As, classic Q&As, but also during the process for you to kind of like begin to think about these questions for yourself before we kind of like try to discuss together about the possibility of answering them, okay? So, first of all, what I like to do as a philosopher is to think about the language, you know, the sentences we use in the ordinary language when we use the word time, okay? So we say, for instance, that we are taking our time, that we have time or we have not time, you know, we are wasting our time, etc. So that suggests that time is like an object we can possess, right? Or a good that is kind of like at our disposal. We have time, we waste time, we take our time, etc. But it also sometimes appears that we make time like as an agent, so to say. When we say, for instance, that time passes, time flies, time destroys things, or time, you know, erases things or stuff like this, we are, you know, pretending that time is a certain type of agent. So usually, by thinking about ordinary language, we find some clues in order to help us define what time is. In that case, I don't think it's actually leading us anywhere close to what the definition of time might be. Because let's think about it for a second. Is really time like a good at our disposal, something that you can actually, you know, physically grasp like this? No, I mean, the metaphor goes obviously, you know, too far away. Is it also an agent of some sort, a subject? No, we are the subject that experience time. So this is not really, you know, a good, you know, metaphor either. Maybe the closest metaphor, and a very common one nonetheless, that we use to describe time would be the metaphor of the water, this fluidity aspect of time that we're going to get back together in a second. So when you think about time, and philosophers have been doing that for a while, when you think about time, you very soon find yourself in kind of an impossibility to define it. When Augustine, which is a very famous philosopher, Saint Augustine, who actually, you know, thought very deeply about time, actually asked himself that question, what is time? He said, then, if no one asks me, I know what is time. But if I want to explain it to a questioner, I do not know. It's like as soon as a question is asked, you're like, wait, what is time? I just, it resists the graspable, the conceptualization of philosophy to a certain extent. So here is the first paradox. The paradox is that while we cannot deny the existence of time, I mean, it seems to be an essential dimension of our experience, right? And our very existence. It seems to be an essential dimension of our perception as well. So while we cannot deny the existence of time, nonetheless, it seems that we cannot really perceive time, right? We cannot grasp it, we cannot touch time, we cannot hear time, we cannot, you know, use our five senses in order to perceive it. So what is it when we say we perceive time? Does it even make sense to say that? So what is it that we perceive is the question, one of the leading questions we're going to ask ourselves. Can we even describe time? Can we describe the experience we have of time? And how does time affect us is also going to be part of that talk. So that's something I'm going to go, like the existential aspect of our relationship to time is going to be the topic I'm going to approach to at the end of the talk, okay? So we're going to go from like a macroscopic view of time, maybe with a bit of, you know, kind of metaphysical aspect of the tentative that has been done to define it. And then we're going to get closer to how it relates to our perception, and then intimately how it relates to our existence. Okay, that's kind of like the angle or the direction I'm going to take with you tonight. Okay, so First of all, let's go back to this like question of definition, what is time? So I am not, you know, I'm not a pro in physics, like far from it. I don't know much about physics. I know about the twin paradox and all that. So if you want, you can ask me at the end. I can give you a brief, you know, blurb about it, but that's about it. But, you know, it's interesting to look a bit at physics because when you look at the relationship between philosophy and physics, you can see that, you know, at best, I would say there is a kind of a complementarity between science and philosophy, but also kind of like a friendly rivalry of sorts. And definitely about the question of time, you see that a lot of philosophers have been reading scientific, you know, books and vice versa in order to kind of get a better grasp at this concept, okay? So let's look at physics very quickly. The funny thing is that when we ask ourselves what is the universe, very often we think about space. Time is not the first thing we think about. We think about space. We spatialize, you know, immediately. What is the world? What is the universe? It's a place before it is time. Though you cannot think about the universe without adding this fourth dimension on top of the three dimensions of space, the fourth dimension of time. Because without adding it, everything would be just purely immobility, and therefore there would be nothing to be said about it. So you need time in order to put physics in motion, in order to put the universe in motion, okay? And also, you know, the laws of physics, when you look at them, obviously what they do is that they start from a moment. So time is essential to the laws of physics. What they do is actually try to describe what happens next from a moment of time. So time is absolutely essential to physics in that sense. Now, this fourth dimension, mind you, is radically different from the three dimensions of space. This fourth dimension is something that doesn't go in any direction. Whereas, you know, with space, I can move to one place and like go back to the first place I was at first, right? With time, I cannot do that. So one specificity of time here that we find in physics, but we don't have to be physicists to know that, is the very irreductible irreversibility of time. So time is irreversible. It just goes one direction. There is an arrow of time, okay? So it's very different than space in that regard. So that's really one thing essential, that we cannot choose to go in which moment, you know, we choose to go. So that doesn't work, despite, you know, Back to the Future type of movies. And it has been a great phantasm, actually, of, you know, pop culture for us to actually deal with time the way we deal with space, traveling in time, etc. If you read like Kurt Vonnegut, for instance, you know, in Slaughterhouse-Five with the Trafalmadorians, you have like all this idea that time would be, you know, kind of like a specialized thing where you pick and choose where to go. You could go, you know, move from past to present to future, etc. And vice versa. So time is irreversible. That's one thing. It's unidirectional. But also, what physics, you know, teaches us is that time is relative, right? So, bon, alors, what does it mean? It just means that depending on where you are, so on the gravity of, like, your position, if you are, like, more, you know, attracted to a gravitational mass, or if you are less attracted to a gravitational mass, depending on your speed, if it's closer or not to the speed of light, and depending on your acceleration, time is going to pass differently. I mean, you know that already, or do you want me to expand a bit of that? So just very quickly, what, you know, Einstein basically discovered is that depending on where you are and at what speed you go and the level of your acceleration, time is going to pass differently. Okay? So if you travel at the speed of light right now on a star, okay, and then come back, which is what the twin paradox is about, okay? And so imagine we are twins, okay, we are the same age. You go travel, you come back, you're gonna be younger than I am. Because you will have traveled very, very fast with an acceleration process that's gonna actually make time go slower for you, which is the weirdest thing when you think about it, but it's true. Okay, so it's like that. So there is like a relativity to time that physics already indicates. Now, I'm not gonna be speaking, you know, mostly about this type of relativity, because this is a philosophy talk, shall I remind you, and not a physics, you know, talk. But, you know, this relativity is actually important to remember. So As a philosopher, I would turn now just to the history of philosophy very quick on the question of time. You find very interesting things in the Greek, you know, philosophy, or Greek philosophy, very broad, right? But one thing that I find very interesting is that at the core of the Greek philosophy, and I would say at the core of all the Occidental or Western philosophy, you have metaphysics, or what we call ontology. Ontology is a science of being. And the Greeks say, most of them inspired by a guy called Parmenid, that the only thing we can know is what is. And in order for us to know something, it needs to be, namely to be immutable, to be stable enough in order to be grasped by the mind. And the problem with time is that its movement, by essence, it's change all the time. It's to become, it's not a to be. Do you understand? So time and being, or time and thinking about what it is to be, have been constantly kind of like opposed in a way. And that was like the great kind of consternation of philosophers. So they try to kind of remedy to that, be like, maybe then time is not like linear. Maybe time is cyclical. And if it's cyclical, then there is a certain type of stability that we might be thinking about, right? So if time is cyclical, this is called like the many theories of the eternal return. Like there would be like a great year in which up everything would just begin again in the same exact way. Certain philosophers do think, like up until, I would say now, but up until at least the 19th century, a lot of philosophers have thought about this idea of like the eternal return. I am gonna leave that possibility aside. Not because I think it's not, you know, valid, but I don't know, there is like a mysticism or, you know, to it that I just like, you know, I just can't share. But I mean, we can speak about it on a poetic level maybe if you want, but like for now, I'm just gonna stick with a linear conception of time. So still, you know, adopting this like linear classic conception of time that we have, we find one position that is very often, you know, remembered is the one of Plato, for instance, who says that time is nothing but a corruption of eternity. Eternity is a real thing. Immutability, not moving, not changing, not degradable, right? And time is just like what we have in our, you know, sensory reality, this like low reality that Plato considered it as being not the real reality. For Plato, the real reality is the reality of the ideas. And that's where eternity is. But what we have, us poor creatures living in this like sensory world that is subject to degradation, to corruption, to change, to death, etc., what we have is just time. And time is just this like corruption or degradation of eternity. So there is this kind of like, you know, misjudgment of time, so to say, or like, you know, kind of, I would say like this pejorative aspect of time that you find a lot in the Greeks. Now, when you think about that, that's like still considering that time is kind of like outside, right? It's like in the world, it's like in reality, in the sensory reality. Now, one of the first philosophers that actually kind of operates this movement of situating time, not anymore in the outer world, but kind of making it an inner reality, is Aristotle. And after Aristotle, which, you know, I cannot develop, you know, all about his conception of time, but basically Kant, after him, has been the one that we like remember the most in the history of philosophy, that made time actually sort of a framework of our perception. So what Kant says is that time is an a priori form or a frame of our perception. What do I mean with a priori? Is that it's not something we can perceive, but it is the tool without which we cannot perceive anything. It is the frame in which we perceive things, just like space, except that space is like the outside frame of time, so of reality, of perception, and time is like our inner frame of perception. Okay, so that's what he says. So here we have a first movement of internalization of the definition of time. Do you still follow me, guys? This is the hardest part. Okay, it only gets easier. I usually do it the other way around, but I thought like, let's get rid of the tough shit first and then, okay, cool. I'm glad you're still there. If you're not, do you have any questions so far? Okay. Okay, so again, so you have kind of this movement. Plato, time is outside of this sensory world, right? It's like, eternity, is outside of the sensory world, and time is this corruption of eternity, okay? And then you have Kant and Aristotle before him who come and say, okay, but like, let's reconsider time and give it some value, you know, again, and let's consider that this time actually it's not so much that time is outside, but it's something that we need to have in order to perceive things in the world, okay? So space is the external form of our sensibility, our perception, says Kant, and time is the inner frame of our perception, okay? But when he says that, Kant, what he says is that we cannot still perceive time. What he says is that time is not an object of perception, it's a means of perception. So my question for you now is gonna be, well, can't we really experience time? Isn't it something that we can actually call the experience of time? Isn't time also some kind of an object that we can perceive and describe by using, for instance, the classical trilogy of past, present, and future? And when we look at past, present, and future, still, you know, kind of like surfing on this like linear, right, conception of time, past, present, and future, my question for you is gonna be, what is real? What is the most real between past, present, and future? So I want to for you to discuss with the person next to you for a few minutes and try to tell me what is the most real between past, present, or future, and give me, you know, reasons for that, okay? So go ahead, you have 2-3 minutes to discuss with each other. In our experience of time, what is more real? The past, the present, or the future? And for what reasons?
I'm gonna go devil's advocate on this. I'm gonna say past is the most real because you can reflect on it, you can ponder it, you can give it some kind of framework, whereas the present tends to be very trippy and hard to be in, you know, because it's new. So it's like a foreign place. Right? So the past is like more comfortable, and then the future is just a fantasy, so.
Okay, anyone else?
I was thinking in terms of music, like if you were listening to a piece of music, you would perhaps have a memory of how it started, and if it's a piece you're familiar with, you would have a sense of where it's going, and of course, you would hear whatever you hear at that moment. So in that sense, maybe they're all equally present or exist equally.
Okay. We'll go back on that metaphor actually soon.
We concluded that the present is the most real because that's where reality is, even if it's constantly moving. It is difficult, though, to get that much done in reality because it's so fleeting and it moves so much. And so the concept of the past is a helpful concept in addition to the concept of the future being a helpful concept. But even though they're helpful, they're not necessarily more real because reality happens in the present.
Maybe I'm sorry, we won't have like everyone, but maybe one more.
I was definitely inclined to say the present is more real, but what that guy said kind of changed me a little bit. That I still think the present is more real, but if you're not paying attention to it and you don't perceive it, what's the value of it then? Is it still part of time if you're not paying attention to it, if you miss the present moment? If, you know, does that... Like, if, you know, we don't live in the present moment a lot. We're lost in thought, we're lost in different things, that's to put it mildly. So if we're not conscious of the present moment, how is that, how does that change the concept of it with respect to time?
And you could also say like remembering can be also, you know, an act of perception in a way of a certain reality, namely our memories, which are also, you know, time stuff, so to say. Yes, so the presentist kind of attitude that we have over there is kind of a classic one. You know, the like a valid one nonetheless, hein? Don't get me wrong. I don't think it's naive to say that what really truly exists is only the present. I mean, when you think about it, you know, the past is already gone. So it's something that just like you cannot, you know, you cannot absolutely, you cannot at all, you know, kind of grasp. You know, it's like traces, memories, but it's not here anymore. So it's reality is not tangible anymore in that sense. The future, it's like even more challenging for the mind to grasp because of like the pure, you know, the pure like imaginative or like a phantasmagory that it is. Like it's not yet, so it's a speculation, a contingence that we have like absolutely no way of grasping. So therefore what's left, so to say, is the present. Yes, but when you think about what the present is, you know, in its instantaneity, in its fulgurance, indeed, in its like slippery aspect, it's always kind of like this mathematical point that up constantly swallowed by the past. Like now, in the now is inexisting. That's why it's a mathematical point. It's not, it doesn't have any density. It's purely abstract. It doesn't have any matter, so to say. The pure now, as like the instant of now, doesn't exist. Time is like this, like now would be like the, you know, the thing that just goes like this, making the future past, etc., etc. But it's not really something that exists within itself. Okay, so that will be like something that a lot of philosophers have noticed, namely Augustine, which actually leads to this other paradox that I want to like share with you. What he says is that if present were always present, if present would be really present all the time, then it wouldn't be time because it wouldn't pass, right? So it would be eternity. It would be out of time, right? It would be immobility if present would remain present. So therefore, for present to be time, for present to be really the reality of time, it needs to be past. It needs to lose what makes him present, so to say. Do you understand the paradox here? It's like, for present to be considered as time, it needs to actually be past, or to be passing, at least, and therefore not be present at all. So present within itself, per se, doesn't exist, doesn't have any kind of like tangible, you know, density, so to say, okay? So that's also what Bergson tries to say, which is a very, you know, very good philosopher, one of the, I would say, probably the philosopher who really kind of made me dive into philosophy when I was young. And what he says is that the pure present is an ungraspable advance of the past devouring the future. So I think that's pretty well said. He's very talented at saying things well. Guys, if you get desperate with philosophy, you try to read Hegel, Kant, all these guys, Heidegger, all these like terrible guys, go to Bergson, you're like, ah, clarity. And elegance, mind you. So he's always like very like on point, clear, and like very, you know. So the pure present is an ungraspable advance of the past devouring the future. In truth, he says, all sensation is already memory. Maybe just like a very recent memory, but it needs to be memory for it to be even felt, right? So past, in that sense, gives form to the present. Right? Maybe it is more real in that sense than the present, to our sense of now. And you could even say that future as well. And here Augustine goes, in fact, what we have, suggests Augustine, is that we have three types of present. We have the present of the past, which is the memory. We have the present of the present, which is like the pure intuition that just like, you know, constantly kind of like he's very ephemeral and constantly switches from past to future. And you have the present of the future, which is the anticipation, the wait. So my now is going to be very different from your now, depending on your memories, depending on how this past has shaped the way you perceive, and depending on your expectations as well, which is also gonna give a certain, you know, form, a certain, you know, color to the way you experience the present. So present without past informing it and future kind of shaping our expectations is really ungraspable as well. So That anticipation, desire, shape our sense of time passing and our experience of the present. Just as much as our accumulated experience, our lived past shapes our present as well, leads me to another type of relativity, not so much the relativity of, you know, physics that we talked about, namely that, you know, two different time can pass like more or less slowly or more or less fast, okay? But relativity in the sense this time of subjectivity of the experience of time, okay? So my next question for you guys is gonna be to basically think about like the objective definition of time, the one we see on clocks, for instance, the time we rely on in our social life all the time. And when, you know, when we say, oh, this is gonna be beginning at 7, etc. Bon, so this objective definition of time versus the subjective definition of time that Bergson and Augustine as well tend to make us think about, okay? So is time basically what we just see on clocks? That's my question for you. Okay, so to what extent time, yes, is what we see on clocks, okay, but also how could we, you know, kind of like give way more to this like personal or subjective appreciation of time, okay? So go ahead, I give you 2-3 minutes to think about this for a second. The difference between an objective conception of time and a subjective conception of time, and maybe their relationship. Go ahead. Who has something to say about this, you know, difference, potentially questionable, between an objective conception of time and a subjective one? Yes?
Something we were talking about, which everybody has experienced, is if you're doing something you like and you enjoy, obviously time seems to fly by. We say it in English, you know, time flies. If you're participating in an event that you find boring, every minute feels like an hour. So everything kind of slows down. So that's definitely an experience we can all relate to and think about.
Absolutely, which, you know, leads me to say that I definitely hope that the first option is happening, you know, tonight. Yeah, absolutely. So there is an emotional aspect or factor to take into consideration in the elasticity of time that differs from one person to the next, depending on interests, depending on, I don't know, mindset, whatever, you know, mood even, that absolutely shapes our relationship to time. What else? Yes, if you don't mind, I think, yeah, thank you.
Hi, I think that objective time is kind of anxiety provoking. So like, I need to get to work at this time, I need to make sure that I go to bed at this time, otherwise I'm gonna be tired. It's just kind of like these measures that are imposed on us or that we impose on ourselves to get things done and to do things in our best interest. But I know that like, at the end of the day, when I think it's bedtime, I'm not actually tired. I'm like, oh, but tomorrow at this time when I have to wake up for work, I will be tired. Whereas I think that subjective time is more about evaluating and assigning worth to things. So like, oh, I talked to my friend forever on the phone. Like, didn't actually do that, but that means that that was like a valuable experience for me. Mm-hmm. Or like, I never eat meat. Whereas like, maybe I have meat like once in a while. But for me, that like is saying, that's like assigning meaning and worth to that, if that makes sense.
I don't know if eating meat has to do with inner time, but I got
like
what
stating
you said,
something, though. I always do this, I never do that. It's more of like that. I think that's more subjective.
Mm. Kind of intimate experience of how like you mature and process things. Right. So the question that that Bergson has been asking himself, and here I go back to this philosopher who has been definitely working on time, specifically in a very, I think, interesting and touching way, is the fact that the objective time, the time that we see on clocks, the time that we read on our watches, etc., is actually not the real time. The real time is our inner time. And in order to better make this distinction between an objective, quantifiable, measurable conception of time and a more like intimate kind of like inner conception of time, he calls the last duration. Okay, so duration is really like the inner intimate conception of time that Bergson is actually trying to emphasize. So The problem, he says, with the time that we have on clocks and all that, is that, well, it's very like circular. It does the same thing over and over. It's very homogeneous. Every second is the same second for everyone. And it's the same second than the same than the second that was before and that will be after, right? It's exactly the same amount of time. It's very quantifiable. What he says when we do that is that we actually spatialize time. All of a sudden, we actually delve into that conception of time as like this long line, right? That has like different, you know, kind of moments like this that are all of the same value or all of the same amount, measurable, quantifiable, just like seconds, minutes, hours, or days can be quantifiable on a clock. And he says that is certainly a very useful conception of time, because it's the only practical conception of time we have in order to socially interact, to agree on like what time to meet deadlines, calendars, etc., agendas of some sort, you know. So of course, very useful in our practical lives, certainly. But is it the most real time? Does it like describe or grasp accurately what our experience of time is? Not at all. First of all, because of the emotional component that we spoke about a second ago, right? So the fact that boredom or excitement is gonna kind of like shape this elasticity of time we spoke about a second ago, but also about the fact that it doesn't insist enough on the continuity of time. So it's the qualitative aspect, the quantitative, sorry, aspect of time, so the time on clocks, kind of like separates, divides time into different like sequences, right? And different like moments that are all the same and universally, you know, acknowledged upon. So not only saying that time is not universally the same for everyone, it's more personal due to the emotion or memories, who we are, our identity, etc., what we expect, so informed by the past and the present, that is very personal to me. But also, it doesn't take into consideration that really, when we, you know, look at our mental states, what happened is not mental states A, switch, mental state B, switch, mental state C, switch. No, not at all. It's not a succession of discrete moments like this. It's more of a flux of an interpenetration, a confusion, in the sense like it like fuses together, con meaning like with, right? So it's like an interpenetration of mental states that kind of like inform one another in a perpetual continuity. And he says that the quantitative conception of time, the mathematical conception of time, the time we see on clocks, doesn't give a fair account to this continuity that we very intimately experience when we look at our inner mental states, the way our consciousness works. It is not this kind of like discrete division of different elements who last the same period of time. It's way more like, you know, embraced than that, right? So, in order to basically make that clearer, I'm just going to say that he uses a type of, I would say, introspective intuition to really describe what, for him, time is, that he calls really duration, that is subjectively, emotionally experienced, fundamentally, personal, that can also change depending on the time you're speaking about something. For instance, maybe right now you're bored to death, but maybe when you think about this event 2 years from now, you're gonna be like, actually, time flied that day, you know? So actually, your conception of a moment also changes depending on if like you're in it or you remember it, etc. So there is also this aspect of, you know, personal or subjective perception of time that needs to be taken into consideration. Now, one little remark here. When I say that Bergson has a qualitative approach of time versus a quantitative approach of time. So by qualitative, I mean subjective, right? I mean intimate. But I'm not meaning like quality time. You know, careful here. Just by qualitative time, I'm just using that term because in philosophy, we oppose it to quantitative, which is like measurable, homogeneous, etc. So it's just the idea that it's something we really feel more than we measure. Okay, that's what I mean with qualitative time. So for instance, he takes this example of like a piece of sugar you put in a glass of water because you want a glass of, you know, of sugary water. The experience of time here is the wait for the sugar to to melt. You just have to wait for it, and you experience that wait. And that is the real experience of time. It's not just like, you know, me calculating, you know, second after second. It's way too like mechanical to think of time this way. Our relationship to time is informed by all sorts of expectations, memories, etc., that give time a certain density, a thickness that you can't find in clocks. Do you get Bergson's points? Okay, great. And he takes the example of a melody, which I think really helps understand the relationship to past and future in our conception of music and in our conception of our consciousness. For him, our very consciousness, our mind, is like a melody. When you listen to a melody, what you're doing is not listening to one note after another, separately. You are remembering the notes that precede, that creates a certain harmony that actually makes you anticipate on the notes that will follow. Or sometimes you might be wrong in your anticipation. Don't mind, you know, that happens. But when you listen to a melody, when you listen to music, it's not a listening to the present. It's the memory of the last notes that actually informs my appreciation of the present note now. Okay? So this is the metaphor he uses to describe the stream of consciousness as duration. So see now, time as duration is not anymore just a frame of our perception, a means in order for us to perceive. It's not even either like an object of perception, but it's more our consciousness itself. So with Bergson, you have again, you know, here again another conception of time in relationship to who we are. It's not only what frames our perception, nor a real object of perception per se that you can grasp, but it's the very matter, the very stuff that makes your stream of consciousness, your consciousness. Okay? So that obviously, you know, is a very original, you know, kind of approach of consciousness, which is pretty unique in the history of philosophy. So, as he said, quantitative time is useful, necessary for our social life, but real experience of time is subjective. This time as duration is not measurable, it is felt, and it is, according to him, the very essence of our inner life, of our consciousness, okay? So duration, again, is not an object of the mind, it's not either a frame of our perception, but it is actually our mind, our consciousness itself, according to Bergson, and the condition of our identity and self-identification. I have here a quote again by Bergson that I would like Kim to read, if you don't mind. That's the first quote here. Again, you'll see how Bergson is clear, and he explained that in his very own terms. Go ahead. Yes, no.
Okay. Yep. Okay. Inner duration, it's dense, so hang out with me. Inner duration is the continuous life of a memory which prolongs the past into the present. The present containing within it the ceaselessly growing image of the past, or more profoundly, showing by its continual change of quality the heavier and still heavier load we drag behind us as we grow older. Without the survival of the past into the present, there would be no duration, but only instantaneity.
Thank you. So that leads me to another, you know, aspect of what Bergson tries to point out, is that not only the conception of time brought us by clocks is too mathematical, too mechanical, it misses the emotional aspect. It misses the continuity aspect, but it also misses the growth aspect. Time continue, like the cumulative aspect of time. Time like kind of like drags behind it always the past, which is ever growing and growing and growing. You don't have that when you look at clocks, obviously. You don't have this thickness of the past carried around and growing as you go. Okay? So these are the two, I would say, aspects that Bergson, you know, kind of like points our attention to by helping us with the concept of duration instead of like clock time, okay? So, I just wanted to like say a little remark here, just a little. I mean, I don't know if, like, I hope I was clear enough on what Bergson means for you to understand the little critique I have now to address him very quickly before we switch to our last part about, like, our existential relationship to time, okay? The way he presents it, very often you have the impression that on the one side you have, like, the objective, quantifiable, measurable, too mathematical time, you know, and on the other side you have, like, inner duration, which is a real intimate experience of time, etc. Bon. Okay, fine. I think to separate the two like this is a bit abrupt. And I would say, like, this is actually a very recent experience of mine that just made me think about it when I was actually, you know, reading this. I was asking a friend of mine, I was like, when is the next time we change, you know, we switch, like, an hour before and an hour after, because I was tired of seeing the sun go down, like, so damn early, and I was like, when are we gonna have, like, long evenings with sun, etc. So I was asking this question, and then I noticed that it made me remember how sometimes actually the time on clocks will affect deeply my inner intimate sensation of time. So it's not as kind of, like, dichotomic as, you know, as Bergson tries to say. It's not like on the one hand you have this time and on the other. I think actually one can also influence the other. Or think of, for instance, when you take a plane and there is, like, a time difference, that also definitely affects your inner life and experience of time, obviously. So there is that, I think, that Bergson didn't take into consideration. Or another aspect, again, like, my father recently crossed the Atlantic on a sailboat, and what you have to do is, like, to have, like, quarters, right? And so it's like you go to sleep at a certain time, and then you're gonna be, you know, driving the boat, etc., and you switch with your partners. And he said that it totally changed his perception of time as well. So the very measure of time actually had also qualitative effects. It's just what I wanted to bring. Well, you take it or leave it. It's just, like, I wanted to, like, put a little nuance here. So speaking about actually this, you know, importance of time in our existence here, now what my last question that I'm going to ask you to finish here is, how do we, or maybe should we, deal with the irreversibility of time that we considered as being, like, the main aspect, right, the main characteristic of time, and the ephemerality as well as time passing. Like, how do we deal with that existentially? How contemplating time passing definitely affects the way we exist, in a good way, in a bad way, how this realization of time passing and, shall I say, our very finitude, the fact that we're gonna die, and we're dying more every day, we're dying right now. Every minute we're dying more. Since the day you were born, you're dying, right? So how is that experience of time actually, you know, how do you deal with it? How do people cope with it? What do you take from it? Do you have an optimistic view of it, or maybe a pessimistic one? Go ahead, think about that for just a second, please. Oh, more than that. Go ahead. All right, guys. Alors, very trivially, guess what? We don't have much time left. I'm sorry. Like, I went a bit overboard with Bergson. You know, that happens. So maybe two remarks, so you have a bit of time for Q&A as well at the end. Great. Oh, okay. All right, so one remark here and another here.
Well, we were just talking about how that perception of time, or the fact that that makes us put value judgments into different phases of time. Like, when you start to perceive time and split it into different parts, then you put value judgments. We consider age to be worse, youth to be better. An example might be, like, menopause. Like, someone could have menopause at, like, 45, and someone else could have it, like, 65. But because we relate it to, like, decay and, like, age and bad things, we see it objectively as a bad thing, whereas, like, in another culture it might be a good thing. And, like, you talk to a lot of people who've gone through menopause and they're like, best thing ever, right? They're like, thank God I don't have hormones anymore. And so it's that value judgment of, like, you know, we're talking with Kim, like, maybe the older we get, the happier we are, but we compare that to, like, what is expected of age, which is, like, to not want to age, right? And so, like, the concepts that you might have in society versus your own experience and trying to, like, define what time really means for you is not something you can do alone and independently, but you have to couple it with, like, what society tells you that is, and that's, like, your own definition of time is, like, straddling those two things.
So, yeah, not only time is, like, you know, informed by, like, social just, like, demands of, like, agenda, calendars, etc., but we have also, like, the social aspect, meaning this time, like, the look, the judgment of others towards how you age, etc. And indeed, I mean, one of our main concerns with time is not so much how to define it. That's what philosophers waste their time doing. It's how to manage it. It's how to manage. We want to manage our time. We want, possibly, we feel hopeless and helpless, seeing ourselves aging, seeing ourselves dying more and more. And it's, you know, we feel hopeless at looking at time going too slowly and we cannot do anything about it, or going too fast, depending on expectations. It chains us up to our past as well, with remorse, regret, resentment, nostalgia, etc. And to our future. Decision anxiety, for instance, fear of tomorrow, fear of aging, of course. We try to escape time, or we try to have a certain control over time by, like, buying some, like, anti-aging creams or doing some plastic surgery, or maybe, like, you know, fall into some kind of religion, you know, with new technologies, thinking that we're going to transplant your consciousness in another body, etc. I mean, this is a real existential concern, for sure, absolutely. And it frames our existence, as you say, in, like, life stages, like birthdays. 1st of January is where we have, like, good resolution, what we're going to do for the year, the prospects we have, etc. So this is really, like, something that, you know, we constantly are concerned with spacing, so to say, our lifespans that way, with, you know, opening and closing new chapters of our life. And we create this way ourselves through time via the look of others onto us as well, absolutely. And we also carry the weight of our finitude's urgency. We're going to die. We don't have time. What are we going to do to make this life meaningful, etc.? It's a big concern of the millennials. You know, we have to make our life meaningful. We have to do something. We have to make a change, you know, to make a difference. Well, so that's, like, all that is, like, this urgency, very stressful aspect of time in that sense. So you have a very, like, pessimistic approach of time, you know, today, I would say, regarding this kind of, like, absurdity towards our finitude, like, we're gonna die, and so why are we here, you know, in the first place, which is a very common, like, existential, you know, way of thinking about it. But also, I would say there is a certain type of optimism that can be reached, either via what we call the carpe diem, which, shall I say, has nothing to do with the YOLO type of philosophy, right? Carpe diem is not YOLO, okay? It's really way more, you know, it's seizing the day, absolutely. And it has to do with being present and enjoying the present for itself, by acknowledging, though, that the uniqueness of each moment is what makes it precious. So it has nothing to do with, like, oh, after me, you know, whatever, you know, it's not. And actually, responsibility is actually a big part of the carpe diem as well. It is a call for philosophical and aesthetical contemplation of what is here and now, given the fact of our mortality, instead of focusing on the past or the future. But contemplating the present that way is actually a very difficult exercise. And here I have a text that I'm not sure we're going to have the time to read, but I'm going to read just the last sentences of it by Blaise Pascal in Les Pensées. He says, "We almost never think of the present. And if we do think of it, it is only to see what light it throws on our plans for the future. The present is never our end. The past and the present are our means. The future alone, our end. Thus, we never actually live, but hope to live. And since we always plan how to be happy, it is inevitable that we should never be so." So there is, like, this kind of pessimism again, you're going to tell me. But now I think there is another type of optimism that existentialist ideas also bring to the picture here, by looking at this future being an end and this urgency. I think that contemplating our own mortality and, you know, the futility of much of what we do, really, prompts and even, I would say, reinforces the question of how we should live, obviously. So there is an empowerment in that sense of contemplating time passing and the urgency of time passing like this. The realization that we can't escape time at all, that we can't escape this time passing and leading to our death, forces us to realize we ought to be careful with our decisions, because we will carry the weight of the responsibility and the way they shape the very person we are. So I'm gonna end on this, and I know I really wish I could have said more about this existential aspect, but I am very eager to hear some of your questions if we can have like a few minutes about that. So I'd rather stop here right now. Thank you very much for your attention, all. How many minutes do we have? Two, three?
We can fit a couple questions in.
Cool.
Thank you. I'm interested in to what extent you think we might be able to defy time. And this is sort of goes back to what you said earlier about conversations between science and philosophy. If you look at sort of quantitative time, so we're born at a certain hour and we die at a certain hour, and between that is our life's time on Earth. But recent studies have shown that people who kind of defy their own biological time and believe that they're 30 years younger than their stated age and live that way, live significantly longer than others. And I wonder whether, as you were saying, that sort of relationship between the quantitative and qualitative thing is actually quite mutable, or rather than being immutable. And to some extent, we ourselves can decide on its destiny.
Are you saying that there could be like a placebo effect of us believing that we are younger?
If we believe that we're longer, we can actually achieve that.
Okay. So in that sense, this time, it's not so much that like the objective time affects our inner like duration, right? But the other way around, the way we feel and experience time passing actually can make us gain time, like win some years. Yeah, okay. That would be like the reverse kind of like aspect of like which one affects which one. Yeah, thank you very much for this remark. Another question, yeah? It's coming over there.
Just wondering if kind of any of the philosophers have discussed, you know, as we spoke most of today on defining time, but kind of the dissolution of time is sometimes when we're at our happiest. And so when time breaks down, when we lose our focus on time, when we lose the meaning of time or the definition of time, if there's kind of been any discussion on the philosophers on that.
Well, the way you describe the dissolution of time reminds me very much of like letting go of the quantitative aspect of time, right? When you lose track of time, as we say, right? Isn't that exactly when we actually experience time the most, but namely not the time on clocks yet again, but the inner time, the precious kind of intimate time that Bergson describes. And that's why, again, he uses the word duration to kind of make it very different. In that sense, it doesn't have anything to do with like, you know, what time, you know, am I gonna be finished, you know, when you are in the studio making music or something like that. You lose track of time, but you feel a very intensely lived and felt, you know, experience of time as well, that's very intimate and that has nothing and disconnects entirely, or lets, you know, all this like quantitative time dissolve itself, you know, to give way to this other aspect, yeah. Thank you.
This is going to have to be our last question.
Oh, well.
That's a lot of pressure. thank you. I was wondering a little bit how philosophy of time, has there been any discourse around the concept of free will? Because it strikes me that a lot of what you're saying about time as a perceptual lens, or time as being our obsession with thinking about the future, or sort of chewing on the past, being about our obsession with our own agency in our lives, and this view that we can tie a narrative through everything, and I could have done something differently, or if I do X, I will achieve Y. But actually, if you have no free will, and if it's all gonna happen anyway, what is time? And maybe it is this mathematical staccato.
Alors, this is a very dense question. I'm gonna break it down and in order to answer at least part of it. Definitely, like the existential kind of concern of time passing with like the responsibility aspect that I brought at the end of this talk is exactly, I think, what you are referring to here. Mm. Sartre, who is one of the most representative philosopher of existentialism, insists heavily on the fact that yes, like our existence or experiencing time is definitely what is gonna then define who we are depending on the action we decide to take. Okay, so what I do is what I'm gonna be. Okay, I'm defined by what I do in time, obviously, because I then carry the trace, the responsibility of this action, okay? And obviously, so this is empowering in a way, but it's also a great burden, which is why he says that free will is actually a prison, so to say, or a burden. He says that it's a kind of a cage of some sort, because then you're always kind of paralyzed by the fear of regret, of potential remorse, of picking the wrong thing. And you don't have time for redos, for do-overs. It's not happening. So there is also this huge anxiety at the very core of the existential philosophy that speaks about like this relationship to time, this irreversibility of time, and us having to act constantly, decide, choose constantly. And by choosing, we renounce to other path as well. And I would say the hardest thing to do in life is to not look back and live in regret and remorse. Mm. And that's exactly what the anxiety at the core of the existential thought, I would say, is. It's like how to deal with this freedom, which sounds great on paper, being free. Yeah, everybody wants to be free, right? Being free is extremely hard because it also makes you responsible for what you choose. So in that sense, maybe being a slave is way more comfortable, would Sartre say, in a way. You know? Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you very much.